Well, you're in short sleeves today.
I am. Well, other than my jacket, I took it off because it's a noisy jacket.
Yeah, it's so for this.
Yeah.
It's strange. I'm not complaining, but most of these Bible studies that we have filmed, I've been in long sleeves for the spring. Usually by this time, I have on my short sleeves and we're going, but today it's raining.
Yeah, 65 out, so I mean, long sleeves probably doesn't feel bad.
No, not at all. Not at all. And the rain makes you feel a little colder anyway. Yeah. I took all my wicker furniture out of our screen and porch and stuck it outside because I'm lazy. And the rain will wash all the pollen off of it.
Yeah,
The
there
next
you
couple of
go.
days,
There you go.
and I'll stick it back in. You might say, will it rot? Nope, because it's wicker. Wicker doesn't seem to care
Work
about.
smarter, not harder.
Yeah, so Quinn and I last night moved it out.
Okay,
Yeah.
yeah.
So for the next 4 days, it'll get a good pounding and
Good washing.
yeah.
I mean, do what you gotta do.
Why clean it yourself when God can do it?
Exactly. God's own pressure washing service.
You know, that's almost an illustration. Like, that almost could make it into a sermon.
God clean you up. You just stand out in the
You know,
rain.
just all you got to do is get yourself out in the rain.
Stop sitting in the screen-in porch.
Let His
Get out.
love rain down on you.
Oh, there it is.
Let it rain.
There it is. Be washed clean.
He washed clean. All right, now on, I guess, to something a little more theologically solid.
Oh, I'm not gonna know what to do. I haven't been here in a while.
Yeah, well, you know. Welcome back.
Yeah.
All right,
Good luck.
here we go.
A great light dawns in Galilee. Some say madman, some say king. Wonder-working rebel priest. Jesus Christ the Nazarene. He knew well what it would take to free us all from sin and grave. A perfect man would have to die, and only he could pay that price.
Welcome to Wednesday night's Bible study. I'm glad you're with us. My name is Philip Brand, and this is Grayson Snyder. Of course, if this is your first time watching this or hearing this on the podcast, I have studied for this, and Grayson is just giving kind of a knee-jerk reaction to that
Got
teachings.
no idea what we're doing.
So we will have a discussion in that particular way.
Yep.
And this happens to be the last Bible study for the spring of 2024.
Yeah, and last time.
Yeah, and we're actually going to end right before the next section of Mark, which is the triumphal entry. And so that's where we'll be in the fall. We'll start in chapter 11 in the fall and finish it out.
Yeah.
I thought that we would be done by now in Mark, but Mark has been surprising
Yeah.
to me. I've said this before, I'll say it again. Hopefully you're not tired of hearing me say it. I just had never done an in-depth study of it, and to really study it and find out some things that you didn't know before. I think I kind of took it for granted, Mark.
Yeah.
So anyway, this is where we are. So turning your Bibles to Mark chapter 10, we are going to start reading with verse 32. It's where we're at, and you have some very small print.
I mean, I've got glasses.
You do. You do.
I can see.
Yeah, I can see it from here.
Oh, so it's not that small.
Well, I can see it at a distance when I get up
Hey,
close.
it could always be
My
smaller.
contacts don't compensate for this sometimes, so I have the large print right here. Yeah, there's some good lighting.
Once I get older,
Yeah.
I'll go to larger print.
That's right. So, verse 32, this is going to be the third prophecy that Jesus has concerning his death, and it's going to be the last one. So what we're going to see is what he says about his death here actually plays out in chapter 11 all the way to the end.
Okay.
So it's kind of a setup in that particular regard. And this is what it says, verse 32, and they were on the road going up to Jerusalem. You always go up to Jerusalem. You never go down to Jerusalem, even if you're coming from the north. It's always up because Jerusalem is up on a mountain.
Yeah,
So they
okay.
always talk in terms of that in Scripture. And Jesus was walking ahead of them, and they were amazed, and those who followed were afraid. And so there's some debate here whether or not the same people were both amazed and afraid, or if it's two groups of people, one that was amazed and one that was afraid. There is a day, Mr. Greek student, starting Greek 3, day, which is but or and. So it could be two separate groups of people. I think it's two separate groups of people. But they might not be amazed for what we think they're amazed with. They could be amazed with Jesus, but they also might be amazed that Jesus is going to Jerusalem knowing that the people or the religious leaders in Jerusalem are against him.
Right.
And so they may know that. That might be a reason they're amazed. Wow, I'm amazed that we're going there. Why don't we just avoid all that?
Yeah.
Could be their thought. We don't really know. And those who followed were afraid. The reason that they were afraid was because they knew that the people in Jerusalem were against Jesus. Yeah. And so we're going into Jerusalem. So we're a little bit leery of going in at Passover week because we're not really sure if they'll lay hands on him or if they'll not lay hands on him. And of course, because we've read through Mark before and the other Gospels, we know that they will capture him and they will put him on a cross.
Mm-hmm.
That is going to happen.
So, not to get off on a little tangent here.
Mm-hmm.
So, the first theory of it being the same group of people, could that be like, if I saw like a tornado in the sky, I'm amazed at its power and destruction.
Right.
But I'm also not going to be like, oh, I'm
good. You're also a little afraid because it's coming toward you.
Right.
And you have decided to head toward it.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Okay. I just wanted to...
Yeah. So either one, it doesn't really matter which one you choose. It's still the same theme.
Right.
We're amazed that we're going because, okay, people are against him.
Yeah.
Or we're afraid because we're going because people are against him. It's still people are against him.
Yeah.
It's the main theme here. So, and taking the 12 again, he began to tell them what was to happen to him, saying, see, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and to the scribes, and they will condemn him to death and deliver him over to the Gentiles.
Hmm.
Now, that particular phrase, deliver him over to the Gentiles, I think we gloss over it some. Because we're thinking Pilate, and we're thinking about the story.
Yeah.
But the Jews never turned another Jew over to the Gentiles, over to the Romans, unless they were really bad.
Mm.
Like, this was the worst of their race that they turned over to those authorities.
Wow.
So he's saying that the chief priest and the scribes are going to think that I'm the worst of the worst.
Yeah.
And they're going to turn me over to the Romans.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm on the level of the, in their eyes, I'm on the level of the most horrific sinners in our society.
Yeah.
Which if you play it out, he definitely took the place on the cross for the most horrific sinners in our society.
Yeah.
So he identifies as an identity in that particular regard. Verse 34, and they will mock him.
Mm-hmm.
They will spit on him. And flog him and kill him.
Hmm.
So that's what's ahead for Jesus. He already knows. He does not arrive in Jerusalem on accident.
Yeah.
He's telling people this is what's going to happen. And he's still going toward Jerusalem.
Yeah, wow.
Okay. And after 3 days, he will rise from the dead. So the sense of this... these verses here is they are moving quickly toward Jerusalem. Like it's not even at a slow pace.
Right.
I don't know about you, but when I have something that's going to be painful ahead, I really kind of dread it a little bit and try to be a little slower getting to it.
How long can I put this off?
How long can I go without doing this?
Mm-hmm.
Jesus is speeding up his tempo.
Yeah.
And probably the reason he's doing this is because this is the purpose he came to this planet.
Right.
This is what he came to do. So we're at this point. The purpose is going to be fulfilled. I'm heading toward it. Let's get this thing done.
Yep.
Yeah. So he's heading in that particular direction. So before we go into the next verses, what is your thoughts about all that?
I mean, one thing that stuck out to me with what you're saying is him being handed over to the Gentiles.
Mm-hmm.
That part about the Jews would only do that to people that they, to other Jews that they despised.
Right.
And that takes the mocking that he gets where they're mocking him, calling him King of the Jews.
Yeah.
That takes that to a new level to me.
Yeah, it does, doesn't it? Because
they're like, look, you are the one claiming to be King of the Jews, but your own people, who would never do this to their own kind unless they hated you.
Right.
They handed you over.
Right.
And that cuts a little deeper whenever it does, you look at it that way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's one thing that really stuck out to me.
Yeah, it really colors those words, mocking and spitting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it does. I had not really thought about that. So yeah. That's a good word.
Yeah. It hurts me a little bit just to like read it, and I'm not even the one going through it.
Right. Yeah, knowing that, and then you see those words. Yeah. That's very potent, if you will.
Potent.
Yeah. I'm working on my vocabulary.
Oh, word of the day.
Word of the day, potent. Yeah. All right, so let's see how they react to this.
Okay.
And James and John, the sons of Zebedee, who, by the way, went up with Jesus and saw the transfiguration, came up to him and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." That's probably a phrase that you need to underline. Okay? "We want you to do whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "What do you want me to do? What do you want me to do?" So, and they said to him, "Grant us to sit one at your right hand and one at your left in your glory." So no sooner had Jesus told them that he was going to Jerusalem to be handed over and he was going to be spit upon and mocked.
Yeah.
James and John come forward, maybe totally missing that message.
Right.
Misunderstanding that message and say, "Hey, when you set up your kingdom, we would like to be on either side."
Yeah.
Now, from other passages of scripture, we know that Mama was behind this.
Mm-hmm.
Mama wanted her two sons on the right and left side of Jesus.
Yeah.
But Jesus is about to make the ultimate sacrifice, and James and John ask for chief seats in his dominion.
Yeah.
We want to be number one, number two and three.
Yeah.
In your,
we know you're about to go die for us and everything, but we want to sit next to you in glory.
Or maybe we just miss that.
Yeah.
And we think this is all symbolic of something else.
Yeah.
Yeah. That this, maybe him being handed over to the Gentiles would prompt God to start a war and wipe everybody out and set Jesus up as the Messiah. Maybe that's what they were thinking.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. "Do whatever we ask." And he said, "Well, what do you want me to do?" So this is definitely an example of blind ambition.
Yeah.
Totally blind.
Yeah.
And sometimes ambition is good and it's not blind. You have ambition to do things for God, to do things for Jesus, to help serve people. And then there's blind ambition. It's all about me. It's all about me. It's about my promotion, what I want to be, and things like that. And this shows that people that are closest to Jesus can be people that have blind ambition.
Right. They're completely missing what he's trying to tell them.
Yeah. Because at the end of the day, we're all fallen.
Yeah.
And our default mode is selfishness.
Mm-hmm.
We have to admit that at some level.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, like the disciples, you know, all throughout this journey, they've kind of had this thought in their mind, this kingdom is going to be set up.
Yeah.
And so maybe James and John are like, "Oh, this is our chance to ask. You know, this is our chance to be at the right and the left."
So a couple of things that John and James knows is there's a banquet, and then there's the dominion.
Mm-hmm.
They know those two things are going to happen because of the Old Testament.
Yeah.
So it's a little vague as to what actually they're asking for.
Mm-hmm.
Even in the Luke passage with thrones and all that going into it. So are they asking to sit at his right and left hand at the table?
Mm-hmm.
Or are they asking to sit with two thrones beside of him? Or are they asking for both?
Yeah, okay.
Either way, they want to be elevated to have special seats of honor.
They're thinking about their position.
Yeah, seats of honor.
Mm-hmm.
Psalm chapter 110 has this sort of, Psalm chapter 110, and we'll get there. It comes after 106 and 107 and 109, right? 110:1 says, "The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool."
Hmm.
So not only is it a position of honor, it's a position of power.
Yeah, okay.
So it's a power grab, it's an honor thing, it's wanting to be first and second in the kingdom.
Yeah.
Yeah, the leaders in the kingdom. So, verse 38 says, Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking." I think that could sum up some of our prayers too.
Yeah.
When we pray for certain things and we want it to be a certain way, God's up in heaven saying, "You have no idea what, you have no clue what you are actually asking mm-hmm. me to do."
Yeah.
And what is involved in answering that prayer.
Yeah.
And you would not be happy if I answered it in the way that you tell me to answer it.
Mm-hmm.
It would change too much and make your hardship worse.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you have no idea what you're asking. "Are you able to drink the cup that I drink or be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized?" Now, they are thinking about the Passover cup because it's Passover time. Passover is coming, and they're thinking of Exodus. And they are also thinking of John's baptism.
Okay. Yeah.
Jesus means neither of those. Okay? "And they said to him, 'We are able.' And Jesus said, 'The cup I drink, you will drink. And with the baptism which with I am baptized, you will be baptized.'" So the drink that he's talking about is the cup of God's wrath.
Mm.
Because in the garden, "Let this cup pass from me, the cup of your wrath pass from me." This has direct references to like Psalm 75:8, Isaiah 51, 17 and 22, and Lamentations 4:21, where it's the cup of God's wrath. And so Jesus is going to take on the cup of God's wrath towards sin.
On the cross.
On the cross.
Yeah.
So that's the cup that he's talking about. He also references this cup in the Lord's Supper.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is the cup.
Yep.
So it's a cup of wrath. The second one, the baptism of John, isn't what he's talking about. He's talking about the overwhelming persecution that you're baptized in persecution.
Mm-hmm.
And that's also another figurative thing that's in Scripture, or analogy in Scripture, that the persecution is so hard that I just feel baptized with. I'm overwhelmed with it. I'm underwater, is what we would say.
Mm.
So they thought it was this positive stuff over here, because all believers think that when you follow Jesus, it's all going to be positive.
Right.
But Jesus is saying to be at that level, it means that you are going to be overwhelmed with persecution, baptized in it, and you're going to drink of the same type of wrath from the world that I have drank from.
Mm-hmm.
So you will be persecuted like I will.
Yeah.
In Acts 12:2, James is killed. His brother is killed with a sword.
Mm.
John isn't. Because John writes the Gospel of John, 1st and 2nd John, and 3rd John, and Revelation. So he stays alive. But but definitely, James dies in a very harsh way.
Brutal.
Brutal way.
Yeah.
John really is brutal too. He's on an island, and he's just left there to die.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a way I wouldn't want to go.
I wouldn't want to. And maybe just give me the sword.
Yeah.
Yeah. Give me the sword. So they didn't know what the cup was. They didn't understand. And they say they're prepared, but Jesus knows that they're not.
Hmm.
However, they did suffer for their allegiance to Jesus, as did the rest of the 12.
Right.
Except for maybe Judas, who suffered because he betrayed him.
He played the wrong hand.
Yeah. So verse 41, "And when the 10 heard it, they began to be indignant at James and John." They were just upset with them. How in the world?
Did you want to
what
finish?
What right do you have?
Did you want to finish verse 40?
"Oh, but to sit at my right hand or my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those whom it has been prepared."
Yeah.
"It's not my choice to tell you."
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Thank you for catching that, because that is what Jesus is saying. "I can't grant that to you because God the Father is the one that grants all that."
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So verse 41, "And they were indignant." They were upset at them. And verse 42 says, "And Jesus called them to him and said, 'You know that those who are considered rulers of the Gentiles lord over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them.'" In other words, he's saying that the way the world leads is you get in a position and then you lord over people.
Yeah.
They are your servants.
Right.
They are your people to command.
Mm-hmm.
And so most Gentile leaders is not the type of leader that I'm going to have in my kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
Verse 43, "But this is the type he's going to have. 'But it shall not be so among you. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant.'"
Mm.
"And whoever would be first among you must be a slave of all." That means you must serve other. So this is where we get that concept of servant leadership.
Yeah, right.
So let me pause here a moment. Sometimes when people talk about servant leadership, they talk about it in terms of following rather than being a leader in serving.
Right.
And so they make a case that every leader should serve everybody and do what everybody else says or tells them to do.
Right.
Well, the moment that a leader starts doing what the people that are supposed to be following him is doing is the moment he's no longer the leader. He's now the follower. Someone else is driving the ship.
Yeah.
Jesus is saying that people need leadership that makes decisions that serve the people, not themselves.
Mm-hmm.
That is for the good of the people, not themselves. Mm-hmm. And we live in an era of time where there is political leaders, leaders of businesses, leaders of school systems, that it's all about what they want to do and not what is best for the children, not right. what is best for the people that is in their care.
Right.
And a leader is supposed to do what is best for the people in their care.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's sacrifices involved, there's servant, we are here to serve, but we still lead.
Yep.
Anything outside of that, just to kind of depower leadership, mm-hmm. is not what Jesus is talking about.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you're basically saying that servant leadership, it's not just doing what everybody else is saying
right.
for you to do. It's you still take charge in leadership. And they might not like your decisions, but you're doing it for the best of everyone around right. you.
Because today we like to throw around the word authoritarian. He should yeah. be authoritarian. He told me what to do, therefore he's authoritarian. That's junk, right?
Yeah.
It's just junk. A leader is supposed to tell you what you need to do.
Right.
But the leader himself is supposed to tell you what you need to do for your benefit, not for his.
Right. And like our authoritarian and their authoritarian that Jesus is talking about here with the Gentiles, that's two completely different.
Or it might be the same.
Well, like when we think of it, I think
oh, when we call get, somebody
we get our feelings hurt.
Oh yeah, because somebody, how dare them tell us what we're supposed
right.
to do?
And in their culture, it's completely normal.
Yeah, our leader just stands up and says, "No, this isn't right." Oh, right. You're authoritarian. No. This is not right, and it benefits you to do what is right.
Yeah. yeah.
Rather than believe something that's wrong or do something that's wrong.
Our authoritarian, yeah. they might have a blunt honesty.
Yeah.
And we get our feelings hurt. What Jesus is talking about with these Gentiles, and, you know, I come to this not studying it, but like lording power over people.
They're running
they
all over
abusing
people.
Abusing.
Yeah, and their not power. Valuing the people that they're leading.
Yeah.
So as you grow in your leadership,
mm-hmm.
you have to remember, I'm in it for the people, and I mm-hmm. value people. So every decision you make should be because you value individuals, not because you value yourself.
Right.
Yeah. And that is early on, that's a hard balance to keep. But the more you get in the habit of doing it, later in life, it will just be second nature
yeah.
to you. Because that's what you trained yourself to do.
Mm.
But you do have to battle it. Yeah. I have to battle it from time to time.
Yeah, you know. It's. I mean, James and John, you might be getting to this in a little bit, but he's saying this to kind of combat, stop seeking your own.
Yeah, you're seeking your own glory. You need to be about the people.
Right.
Value people, not your position.
Right.
Value people, not your power.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and serve them, lead them in my direction.
I'm drinking this cup of wrath to mm-hmm. serve people.
Yeah, and so to top it all off, verse 45, for even the Son of Man,
mm-hmm.
who has the right to lord all over you and run over you and squish you down.
Yeah.
For even the Son of Man came not to be served,
mm-hmm.
but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. By the way, that particular word ransom for many throws us back to my favorite book in the Bible, Leviticus. It does. Leviticus chapter 25, verses 47 through 55, that talks about how... if slaves are bought and then someone sees that, a person can come and buy those slaves, ransom them back into freedom.
Okay.
So there was a system to where your relatives didn't have to remain slaves. You could actually purchase them back.
Mm.
So Jesus is saying, I'm purchasing these people back from slavery.
Mm.
Satan and the world has them right now. I'm purchasing them back. I'm ransoming them so that they can be free in me.
Mm-hmm.
And that is just a beautiful, beautiful thing.
Yeah.
By the way, the one who serves many passage here actually goes back to Isaiah 53. the one suffering, the ones he's suffering for. Like, I'm suffering not for myself, I'm suffering for other people so that they can have freedom.
Mm-hmm.
That's in Isaiah 53. The idea of a substitutionary sacrifice is in Isaiah 53, mm-hmm. which Mark is emphasizing here.
Mm-hmm.
So he's pushing us back to Isaiah yet again.
Yeah.
And then the concept of ransom paid by one party for the sins of another pushes us back to Leviticus. But it also pushes us also to that Isaiah passage, because mm-hmm. that's what Jesus is doing.
Yeah.
That's what that humble servant is doing in that particular passage.
Yeah.
So it would be very interesting for us to, I think, well, at least for me, I don't know about everybody else, it'd be interesting to kind of dig into that a little bit and see how many parallels is between this particular passage and Isaiah 53
mm-hmm.
and kind of bring them to light in a Bible study. We'll see if that can happen in the future. But nonetheless, that's definitely what Mark is doing here. He is borrowing from Isaiah 53, which is yet another argument that Mark is not written to Gentiles. It's written to Jews, and it's speaking into something the church is going through at the time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which I've also thought about doing a Bible study on that, just showing that throughout the book of Mark. I mean, I'm toying with that for next year, but we'll see. We'll see how that
goes. Got some future plans.
Maybe. Yeah, you know how it is. I don't live in today. It's tomorrow.
This is a little teaser.
A little teaser, maybe, for the fall. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so anything about that?
I mean, just the biggest thing to me was just kind of this overarching theme, and we hit on it. Jesus is telling him, you know, stop thinking about your own glory and all of this. You're not understanding. You can't drink this cup that I'm going to drink. You can't be baptized like I'm going to be baptized.
Right.
Stop seeking after yourself in this power position and start thinking about other people.
Yeah. So Sunday, I talked about being visible. The more visible you are, the more invisible you are.
Mm-hmm.
The more visible you make yourself, the more invisible you feel on the inside.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't get a chance to really unpack that, but leaders that lord over people want to be visible, want people to see them, want people to think that they're important, but on the inside, they're very invisible.
Right.
And I tried on Sunday to figure out how to take the invisible, visible thing and make it something else, like an opposite to it. But I think if you live the way Jesus wants you to live, invisible and visible isn't part of the equation.
Right.
It's, do I see other people?
Mm-hmm.
Are they visible?
Mm-hmm.
And so when you lead, it's the benefit of people. They are visible to me. And when people are visible to you, you're not worried about if you're invisible on the inside.
Right.
You're worried about or concerned about, or your goal is to help them the best way that you can.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, I thought that I'd throw that in for free.
Yeah, that's good.
As if they paid for the podcast. Okay. So verse 46 through 52, Jesus heals blind Bartimaeus. Is the title of this. So this section ends with him healing a blind man, which is a reference to Isaiah, actually. It's also a reference to 2 Samuel chapter 5, verse 6. So before we get into this, let's go to 2 Samuel 5, verse 6. I just want to read what King David said as he is going up to Jerusalem. 2 Samuel chapter 5, verse 6 says, "And the king," that's David, "and his men went to Jerusalem against the Jebusites, the inhabitants of the land, who said to David, 'You will not come in here, but the blind and the lame will ward you off,' thinking, 'David cannot come here.'" So as a result of this particular thing, he's taken over Jerusalem. David made a decree that no blind people could be in Jerusalem.
Hmm.
So he would kick out the blind people. He'd kick out the lame people. You couldn't be in Jerusalem during his reign.
Hmm.
He got rid of those. Jesus is doing the same thing, except for he's not kicking the people out that are blind. He's kicking out blindness.
Wow. That's awesome to think about.
Yeah. So David's a great king doing that.
Yeah.
But Jesus is even better, because he's getting rid of the blindness
yeah.
so that those people could be in...
Taking away the defections.
Yeah.
That's incredible.
Yeah. It's crazy. Okay. And they came to Jericho. By the way, Jericho at this time is the oldest city in that area.
Mm.
It had been rebuilt. Wasn't supposed to be, but had been rebuilt. And he was leaving Jericho with his disciples and a great crowd. Bartimaeus, a blind beggar, the son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside. This is both Aramaic and Greek language here. Son of Timaeus, and where he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. So there's a couple of things that Mark is doing. He's identifying the blind man so that you can go talk to him if you want to validate the story.
Mm-hmm.
Second thing he's doing is he's telling you that they are very close to Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
So the pace is picking up.
Mm-hmm.
They're right at it. Like they're within a few, like a day or so of Jerusalem, very close to Jerusalem. And Jesus, when he heard, And when he heard, verse 47, that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. Now, this is only the second time in Mark that Jesus is identified as the Messiah.
Mm-hmm.
The other person was Peter.
Okay.
Jesus, you are the Christ.
Yeah.
You are the Messiah.
Yeah.
This other one is Barnabas, who is blind.
Mm.
So it implies that a blind person can see who Jesus is better than the disciples.
Mm. Spiritual blindness is worse than physical blindness.
Is worse than physical blindness.
Yeah.
He at least knows who he is. Yeah. So, and many rebuked him. So the crowd is rebuking him, saying, be quiet, quit, you're irritating us, telling him that to be silent. But he cried out all the more, son of David, have mercy on me. So he is connecting Jesus with the line of David as the Messiah. And Jesus stopped and said, call him. And they called the blind man, saying to him, take heart, get up. He is calling you. I think it's incredible he didn't stop.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't stop when people were telling him to stop.
Mm-hmm.
How much tenacity do you have in your faith when other people around you are telling you to stop, crying out to Jesus, depending on Jesus, whatever it is about Jesus, and you decide to stop because they're telling you you're an idiot for doing this. You're bothering them.
Yeah.
Faith is, I know this is what I'm supposed to do, and it doesn't matter what the crowd says. I'm going to do it anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that is faith. So verse 50 says, and throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. Now, what we don't understand about the cloak, and I know that's broad. There may be somebody listening or somebody watching, or you may even understand this. But what doesn't come to our 2024 minds is that when he threw off his cloak, he is throwing away all the money that he had made that day, all of his possessions for that day.
Yeah.
So the cloak, throwing it off means that it really wasn't on his shoulders. You would actually put it on your lap.
Mm-hmm.
And so the cloak would have the money in his lap.
From him begging.
From him begging. Mm-hmm. So do you see that? So when he threw off the cloak, it's not like he's taking it off his shoulders and he's running.
Mm-hmm.
He gets up immediately and all the money goes everywhere.
Yeah.
So he's leaving the money behind.
Yeah.
This is in contrast to what other story that we have covered?
Oh no.
Just recently. I don't know if you were here for that one. I don't remember.
I might not have been.
That.
If I can take a guess, was it the last one?
It's in chapter 10.
Is it the rich young ruler?
Rich young ruler.
Okay.
Who, he wouldn't leave his possessions to follow Jesus. Here's a guy that's leaving everything to follow Jesus. And I know that the rich guy has more.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But really, if you are poor, what you have is more valuable to you than what rich people have. Because it's all you have.
Yeah, it's a necessity at that point.
Yeah, it is it's a need.
Yeah.
You have to have this. So he got up. And so this is a contrast here that Mark is doing at the end of this section. Verse 51, and Jesus said to him, what do you want me to do for you? Now, where have we just heard that?
Oh, with James and John.
With James and John, what do you want me to do?
Yeah.
You're asking me to do something? What do you want me to do? Right? In verse, and he says in verse 51, and the blind man said to him, Rabbi, let me recover my sight. Now, that particular word rabbi there means master teacher. It's not the same word as teacher as before.
Mm-hmm.
And there's only one other person that's used that word in Mark, and that is Mary Magdalene.
Hmm.
So she has used it, he has used it. The only two people that have used this particular calling of Jesus, name of Jesus. So let me recover my sight. And Jesus said to him, "Go your way. Your faith has made you well." And immediately he recovered his sight and what?
And followed him.
Where's his cloak?
He didn't go pick it up.
He didn't, it doesn't say. But the implication is he didn't go back to pick it up.
Right.
Someone may have brought it to him. Someone may have brought the money to him. But being able to see was value enough for him.
Yeah. Yeah.
So when it comes to spiritual sight, let's just take this on the spiritual level.
Right.
Is it more valuable for you to see spiritually and see correctly? Or is it more valuable for you to hang on your stuff here on earth?
Mm.
Is it more valuable for you to follow Jesus and your possessions really don't matter that much?
Mm-hmm.
Or are your possessions really what's holding you back from really giving your life to Jesus?
Yeah.
Mm. Some people don't tithe because they're afraid that they can't make the bills next.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Jesus is saying, you've got to leave it all.
Yeah.
You give me the 10% and you don't worry about the 90.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to take care of my people. So is what you have more important than following Jesus? Or is following Jesus more important than what you have?
Mm. That's good.
That's, yeah. So a couple of things. Isaiah chapter 42, verse 18 says, "Hear you deaf and look you blind that you may see."
Hmm.
Which is a messianic prophecy.
Yeah.
There, so it ties in right here.
Jesus is fulfilling that.
That's right. And I guess that's it.
I mean, if I can throw something out there.
Sure, just throw it out there, Grayson.
Like that Son of David, we recognize that as a messianic title.
Yeah.
Right? But one thing that you were talking about earlier is that 2 Samuel passage.
Right.
And it's like, here comes this descendant of David who this title that we throw out here is going to be attributed to the Messiah.
Mm-hmm.
But also where David is kicking out the blind because he can't do anything about their defection.
Right.
This descendant, this Messiah who comes after David, I'm going to throw back to that and I'm going to show you how he is better than David.
Yeah.
How he is the new king who can heal the blind, who has power over the physical defections of people. I think that was pretty cool how Mark did that very subtly. Like, he did it with a messianic title to show you this is the Messiah.
Right.
But I'm also going to show you this 2 Samuel passage.
Right.
Where David couldn't do this.
Yeah.
And I thought that was pretty cool.
Yeah, and the people that are reading this are making that connection better than we do.
Mm-hmm.
Because they didn't really have the Bible in front of them. They had to listen and memorize mm-hmm. all the facts and keep those facts in their mind.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have to do that today. We can now Google it. We are really lazy.
Yeah.
I'm not downing anybody, but the fact is, because we can Google anything at any moment,
Bible search,
we don't have to remember anything.
Right.
Right? They had to remember it all. So when they're sitting in their house church and they're listening to Mark being read,
mm-hmm.
they are making the connections
yeah.
because they are trying to remember everything that is said. So yeah of course they went back to that second Samuel passage. And that is really, I mean, if I am not able to do this because, you know, you have to follow God's schedule, but that would be a message,
mm-hmm.
you know, like a sermon on a Sunday morning.
Yeah.
That would be a very powerful, I think, sermon.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's incredible the callbacks that Mark is making.
Yeah. Long before there were Easter eggs in movies and
like TV the ones
shows.
Where we were watching whatever
movie.
We're
like, wow,
movie.
Look what they did. God was already doing it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then he throws my favorite line right there in the last verse, and immediately.
And immediately.
Yeah.
That's right. And immediately he recovered his sight.
Yeah.
Immediately, yeah.
I thought I was going to go this whole Bible study without hearing immediately.
No, you can't go far through Mark without hearing that. All right, well, that wraps up the spring Bible study.
Starting again in the fall?
Starting again in the fall. It'll be in September, and we will be in chapter 11 of Mark, and we'll start with the triumphal entry, which I'm excited about.
Oh, yeah.
So we will spend a lot of time, because there's 16 chapters
yeah.
to cover. cover there, so I don't know when we'll finish exactly. And what other type of weaving we can do with Mark.
Yeah.
Yeah, like I was thinking of a couple of Bible studies about bridging the passages together and things that we didn't talk about at the beginning, but do that in the fall. Anyway, I'm about to bore everybody.
Well, so I mean, they're just going to have to tune in.
They're going to have to tune in and see what happens.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, that's it. Grace and peace to you.
Heaven sings to Him alone. We watch and wait like a bride for a groom. Oh, church, arise, He's coming soon.